mountains.
Welcome to Back in the Day Friday. I'm Mia, and here we have Old Man Nevitt. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. How about you, Woolsey?
Pretty good.
Yeah, not bad. Well, it's been a long time, but we're back here on Back in the Day Friday. You know, you young people, you crank stuff out. You want new stuff every day. But here on Back in the Day Friday, we're about quality, not quantity. And we're back today. So tell me, I imagine the old Back in the Day Friday mailbag is overflowing. What do we have in the Back in the Day Friday mailbag today, Woolsey?
I'm glad you asked. So, dear Old Man Nevitt, I saw this old picture of my great-grandpa, and he was wearing some type of straps that were attached to his pants and went over his shoulders. What's up with that? Sincerely, Joseph.
All right, well, Joseph, thanks for writing in. So what you saw there on old grandpa are called suspenders. They're called suspenders. So you ever seen these Woolsey suspenders? You kind of wear them on the belt, go up over the shoulders?
No.
All right, so those are called suspenders. Kind of a, you know, the belt's ugly cousin. And so what the deal is with suspenders is that they started back in about 18th century France with just ribbons. And then back in around the 1820s, British designer named Albert Thurston started to develop them. They called them braces in Britain, braces. But the thing is that, so the pants, the style of pants was really high-waisted pants back then. If you wanted to be in style, you wore your pants way up high around your waist.
Like a now, minion.
Yeah. So what do you think happens, though, when you're wearing a belt with high-waisted pants like that?
No.
You have no idea. I'll tell you what, it doesn't work. It doesn't work because you have to hike it up, you know, and the belt, it's either just going to slip right back down because belts are really made to kind of go over the hips, the waistline, or you're going to have to pull that belt really, really tight. Well, you pull that belt really, really tight, and now what's going to happen? You're going to lose your lunch, and that's not going to be very good when you're out, you know, courting the young ladies, and your belt's so, you know, so tight that you lose your lunch. So, you know, the suspenders, they give you the best of both worlds because they developed a style, you know, the stylish, and they keep your britches from falling down while you're out courting. With suspenders, you know, there were several styles. You got the Y back, the H back, the X back. But either way, you're looking sharp when you're out there on the town.
That sounds disgusting. So what's our back in the day artifact for today?
All right, back in the day artifact. Really excited about this week's back in the day artifact. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right. What do you think that is?
Toilet paper. Obviously.
Toilet paper.
Yes.
It's not. I'm insulted, Woolsey. It's not toilet paper. And you know, do you know what they used for toilet paper back in the day?
I don't want to know.
You don't want to know. Trust me. You don't want to know. No, not toilet paper. Take another guess.
A scroll.
A scroll. Well, it does. It does scroll, but it's not a scroll. So you see, what we have here is the. A long sheet. It does unscroll. It has these perforated spots. And you have to read this from bottom to top. What does that say right there?
Won't you come home, Bill Ball?
Bill Bailey. Yeah. Won't you come home, Bill Bailey? So won't you come home, Bill Bailey? Do you know that song? Of course you don't. But won't you come home, Bill Bailey? Famous song from way back in the day. And what this is the roll for a player piano roll, a player piano. So that means that the piano actually played itself. It doesn't need a player. The piano is the player. So
how does that work?
Well, that I'm glad you asked, Woolsey. Glad you asked. So back in the day, you know, we didn't have all the InstaChat and the Call of Fortnite and all these things that you guys keep yourself entertained with these days, and people had to find a way to entertain themselves in the home. So a lot of people played music, could play piano. You play any instruments?
I play the piano, actually.
You play the piano. It's amazing. I thought that you guys just played the you know, the Guitar Heroes and things like that. But yeah, back in the day, a lot of people would play the piano, but what if you didn't have the, you know, if you couldn't play the piano, nobody in the home could, or even worse, this was during the Industrial Revolution, all right, and lots of people, you know, work in those dangerous factories, lose your hands, or your hands are mangled. Do you work in a factory?
No.
No, where do you work?
Nowhere.
You don't work?
No.
You're 14 years old and you don't work? Back in my day, you're old enough to walk, you're old enough to get out there and earn a living. You young people just get lazier every year.
Yep.
But yes, so the player piano solves that problem. There's nobody in the home to play. In the house, the player piano provides music. There's no radio back in the day, and it gives you some music. And so there were some different people worked on developing something like this. Early methods, they tried to use rotating wooden blocks. Never worked quite right until a guy named Edwin S. Vogtey. Edwin S. Vogtey developed in 1895. He got to work in his workshop there in Detroit, and he developed a version that had a big cabinet in front of the piano, so where the piano player would sit, where you sit when you play, when you play the keys. It sat in front of the piano, and there were wooden arms that actually came out of it over the keys, and would press the keys. And
wait,
so
the arms would come out of the cabinet.
Yes, the arms were out of the cabinet. And so it had a couple of foot treadles that would you would have to play these foot treadles with your feet, and the valves would create air, which creates that suction to make them work. And so what happens is when you see these different holes, as there's a roll tracker, and as it passes the different holes, that tells it what key to hit. You notice that some of them are longer than others shorter. So that's for dynamics. You know, how long to hold the key, how hard to press the key. So you know, it was a little cumbersome to have it in the front. So eventually, the cabinet is moved inside, and as more people work on this idea, they're able to move the cabinet inside, and instead of having to have wooden fingers, it just happens inside the piano. The keys are struck, and so you'll see the keys moving. There's nobody there. You know, it was a great way.
Creepy.
Yeah, in the early days, it was a great way to play a little joke. You know, on old grandma that didn't know about this new modern technology like the player piano. You know, she thinks grandpa's ghost is back tinkling the keys once again. So in 1897, the Aeolian Company acquires the rights. They create the pianola company, and then it evolves over time. The Melville Clark with the Apollo Company builds the mechanism that actually moved it inside, like I told you. Around 1908, they moved to an 88 key. Wake up, Woolsey, pay attention.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I tell you what, the attention span of you young people, you wouldn't even make it through one little song these days.
True.
Much less a piano concerto, and they did put great works, you know, by
piano
people.
Music makes me sleepy.
Pretty much everything, but the InstaChat makes you kids sleepy. But they did put great works by, you know, current composers like Debussy and Rachmaninoff on these, and people really loved it. So they moved to 88 keys, the full keyboard, and you know, companies like Velte Mignon in Germany and Pico Duo Act created what they called the reproducing pianos, and that enabled them to use more dynamics and tempo and things like that that were at first hard to reproduce, you know, the way a human pianist would play. And so they became very popular all the way through the 1920s. But then a couple of things happened to kind of depress the market for the player piano. One, stock market crash of 1929 put a lot of the player piano companies out of business when the Great Depression hit. And then number two, 20s and 30s, we have new technologies developing. We have the radio, we have the record player, the phonograph. And so now it was easier and cheaper for people to actually listen to music in the house. And, you know, like many new technologies today, it washes away the great things. And now people are just stuck to that electricity technology. So There's still a few of them around, and this you can see right here. Bill, basically, won't you come home, please? Tempo is 75 here. Vintage, yeah, vintage. Right now, you'd have to double that tempo to keep you young people interested. But this is a vintage player piano roll. So thanks for tuning in. Send us your letters right here to the Back in the Day Friday mailbag. We don't take texts. We don't take emails. We don't take twits. Just letters. Send it to 501 University of Texas Trail. Back in the Day Friday mailbag. We might read your letter right here on the air. I'm Old Man Nevitt. This is Mia. We'll see you next time. Back in the Day. Let's go back. Let's go back. Let's go way on the way back when. I didn't even know you. You couldn't have been too much more than 10.